definitive about Sandy Macpherson.
This is the BBC Home and Overseas Service. From my postbag. Now, Sandy Macpherson has been sorting and delving into the letters that he's received from listeners during the past week, and he's going to give you now the selections that he's chosen. Sandy Macpherson at the BBC Theatre Organ.
Famous signature tune I'll play to you was played by Sandy Macpherson on the original BBC theatre organ. As you probably all know, this lovable, lanky Canadian organist passed away peacefully a week ago yesterday on his 78th birthday, and tonight the Organist Entertains programme remembers this giant of the console and all the happiness his music brought us over the years. I shall be talking to one or two of his close friends, but first, let us hear that warm, homely Canadian voice as we remember it, coming from the old BBC St. George's Hall, with Sandy Macpherson at the Compton Theatre Organ.
Good afternoon, everyone. Well, here I am once more on the home service, and I'm going to begin with a march that's been asked for, a march by John Belton called Down the Mall.
Macpherson, as he was christened, was born in Paris, Ontario, the son of a bank manager, but it was his mother who encouraged early piano lessons. As a youngster, Sandy accompanied the silent pictures in a flea pit called the Palace Cinema in Amherst, Nova Scotia. after getting bored with his job as a travelling cigarette salesman. Eventually, he joined the famous Metro-Goldwyn-Mayer circuit as a featured Wurlitzer organist, and in 1928, he was brought over to open the Empire Cinema in London's Leicester Square. Here's the sound of Sandy at this famous organ, recorded nearly 40 years ago. Friendship with Sandy started at this time when I was a schoolboy in London, and I waited at the stage door for his autograph. And Sandy let me play the organ on Sunday mornings, which was very kind of him, as this was the only opportunity he got to practice, the theatre being open 12 hours a day. Now, in 1938, Sandy Macpherson left the Empire Leicester Square and took over the BBC organ bench from Reginald Foort, who was leaving to tour the music halls with a massive great pipe organ. Sandy's first broadcast on the Compton organ in St. George's Hall took place on November the 19th. And on the outbreak of war, he started his marathon stint.
For the first 2 weeks, my organ programs were practically the only broadcasts from the capital. The Sunday before war was declared, I was suddenly brought back from holiday. If the worst did happen, John Watt said that he'd want me to do 27 programs in the first week. But as the Radio Times was going to press almost at once, the details of the programs would have to be ready that same afternoon. And just as I was going, John said, "I've been breaking this to you gently, Sandy. I forgot to say we shall also want 23 programs for the following week. Details tomorrow, please." I started on that memorable Sunday, and the first tune, or one of the first tunes I ever played in wartime, was this.
Story I remember about Sandy at that time. One night during the Blitz, he was called from his shakedown bed at the BBC in the early hours, just opposite St. George's Hall, and he actually broadcast the organ in his pajamas, dressing gown, and bedroom slippers. No mean feat, I can assure you, for an organist. On September 24th in 1940, St. George's Hall and the organ were destroyed by bombs, and for a time, Sandy continued broadcasting on an electronic organ until the time the BBC took over Reginald Foort's touring Moller organ, and it was installed in the Grand Theatre Llandudno, from where we hear Sandy now.
Good afternoon, everyone. This is Sandy at the Theatre Organ, bringing you another in this series of Thursday afternoon programmes chosen from my post bag. And I'm beginning today with the March Militaire by Schubert. This has been asked for by Mr. A.W. Jones of Granville Street, Leamington Spa. Thank you.
the peak of his request programs, Sandy was getting 6,000 letters a week, and in 1946, the BBC Moller Theatre Organ was moved back to the Jubilee Chapel in Hoxton, London. Ted Hockeridge started broadcasting with Sandy, and I phoned Ted to ask him how they first met.
Well, Robin, I was about 20, I think, when I first met him. I was a rookie in the Canadian Air Force over here, and I think he heard me singing at a Forces concert or something. And he got the BBC to approach the RCAF about borrowing me to sing on some of his Forces broadcasts whenever I had a 48-hour pass coming to me. And I used to hop the train up to Bangor.
Oh, yeah.
And do these shows with him. Great fun, too. Marvelous. I guess he really gave me my start. I owe him a great deal. I can honestly say that.
Yeah, I think we all do, Ted. But do you remember any particular little incidents about him as a man?
Oh, yeah. Well, he had a great sense of humor, you know.
Oh, yeah.
And we used to hit it off terrifically. I can tell you one little happy memory I have. He came to Canada one year when I was over there, and I took him on a fishing trip with an Indian-type canoe on the roof rack and rods and tackle and supplies in the back of the car. We pushed off up into northern Ontario to the very beautiful mountain, lake, and timber country of Algonquin National Park, and this gorgeous lake called Lake Opiongo. Absolutely nobody there. And we were fishing in the canoe, drifting a few yards out from the shoreline. And the only sounds that cut through the silence were those of maybe a flight of wild ducks slicing across the sky, or the occasional slap of a beaver's tail echoing across the surface of the lake. And Sandy, he loved it all. He absolutely loved it. Took it all in. And then with that slow grin of his, he suddenly said, "What a place this would be to play the organ."
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah.
Typical of him, actually.
Yes.
The super guy. He was a great friend. I shall never forget him.
Gardens, the Stephanie Gavotte. And probably one of Sandy's most popular programs of all time was the Chapel in the Valley, which ran for over 20 years. And here's the way he introduced it.
Good morning to you all. This is Sandy here to welcome you once again to our Chapel in the Valley. I hope you're all in the mood this morning to listen to some of these old hymns and one or two sacred songs that have been chosen for the services which are to be held here at the chapel later on today. Well, all our friends have been busy rehearsing the music for some time now. Mr. Edwards, Anne, and of course the chapel organist, Mr. Druitt. And I think we might go inside now and join them for the next half hour while they carry on with their rehearsal.
of course, Mr. Druitt was none other than Charles Smart, to whom Sandy dedicated his book with these words. To Charles Smart, who by his invaluable assistance, sound judgment and unfailing good humour, has helped me over many a rough patch, this book is gratefully dedicated. So that's what Sandy thought of you, Charles.
That was really wonderful. I was very surprised when I read the book and I turned to the first page and there it was.
Because you knew him for years and years, didn't you?
I met him, first of all, I would think about 1928. He was the organist of the Empire, Leicester Square.
That's correct.
And I was at the Plaza Lower Regent Street. And we used to meet quite a lot and exchange ideas about the organ solos we were supposed to perform in between the films. And it was there that Sandy gave me and taught me my job, really.
Well, he was a great showman, wasn't he?
He was a great showman.
People missed those golden days, a lot of people did, when he played at the Empire and all those beautiful slides and effects and things.
Yes, and that's where I learned a lot of my ideas from him. Quite a lot.
Then later on, of course, during the war, you were associated with him quite a bit.
Yes, we were together at Evesham, and then we went on to Llandudno and Bangor.
What was that, about 1941?
41, that's right, during the Blitz. Big Blitz started, that's right.
And then, of course, I suppose the most popular program you two did together was Chapel in the Valley.
Oh, yes, no question. So that started, first of all, as you know, from the little chapel in Hoxton. Incidentally, Mary Lloyd went to Sunday school there. Not many people know that. And after that, we recorded in Broadcasting House, Maida Vale, All Souls, Langham Place.
Mm-hmm. With a couple of singers, too, you had.
Singers, yes. We had two wonderful bass singers, bass baritones, Harvey Allen and Michael Rippon. Three little girls, Marion, Anne, and finally Hazel. By the way, there was one funny little story. One listener wrote in to say that he felt sure that the bird noises that used to bring in the recording were made in a little tower above the chapel, and that Sandy used to go up into the tower and throw in a little bird seed in order to make the birds sing for our entry.
Well, of course, you two really had similar personalities. Of course, when he came over to the Empire and opened it with Reginald Foort, there was a wonderful clash of personalities, because of Fiery Foort, you remember?
Yes, and Quiet Sandy.
Mm-hmm.
Yes, he was quiet always, but a great pal and most reliable friend one could wish to have.
Sandy Macpherson playing the Gaumont State Kilburn Wurlitzer. With the loss of Sandy Macpherson, there's a gap which can never be filled in the annals of broadcasting. So let us once again recall that homely, friendly Canadian voice, so much a part of radio in the 40s and 50s.
Well, I'm afraid I've only time for one more request today, and I'm going to conclude this program with Pedro the Fisherman from the musical play The Lisbon Story. And I'm playing this for four sisters who come from Belmont, near Bolton, Lancashire.